Hello, ChemCom. Today we're going to continue on with our exploration of petroleum. We're going to take a look at the refinement process and how we model the covalent bonds that hold petroleum molecules together. Let's get started. We've already talked about how crude oil is the unrefined petroleum that comes out of the ground. And within that crude oil, there's a bunch of different types of molecules, some very small, some very large. These different groupings of different sized molecules are called fractions. And refinement separate these fractions into their different groups so they're easier to use. These fractions have a variety of different properties and they can be used for a lot of different things. The way we separate them is through a distillation process called fractional distillation. You get a very tall column or silo and you heat up the petroleum inside that. That takes the petroleum from the liquid phase to the gas phase, and as it becomes a gas, it will rise up the column where we can harvest it out. So typically speaking, the lightest molecules will boil off first and reach the top of the fractional distillation tower first. The heavier molecules tend to stay closer to the bottom. And in this way, we can separate the different molecules within a barrel of petroleum. You can see here some of the different chemicals we can get out of one barrel of petroleum. So you can see the crude oil comes in down here at the bottom and we heat it up. And as we heat it up, the lighter molecules, the smaller molecules, are going to end up here toward the top. Bottled gas like petroleum, gasoline, other chemicals, even jet fuel would go toward the top of this distillation tower. Then toward the bottom, you have heavier fuels like diesel fuel, lubricants, and things we make plastics and waxes out of. Even asphalt comes out of a barrel of crude oil. It would be one of the heavier molecules and stay toward the bottom. So what's happening here is when we have a barrel of crude oil, there's different molecules there, and they have intermolecular forces. They're very weak, but those intermolecular forces are holding those molecules together in the barrel. That's why they stay as a liquid. And as we heat up that liquid, those intermolecular forces are overcome, and they separate, becoming a gas. Let's talk about the different fractions within the fractional distillation tower. We'll start with the smallest. If something has a very low boiling point, below 40 degrees Celsius, it's going to be 1 to 4 carbons in length. They're going to have very weak intermolecular forces, and typically because of that, they'll boil quickly and move to the top of the tower. Propane and other types of fuel would be in this category. Then we get to liquid fractions, things that are typically liquid. These would be things with boiling points between 40 degrees Celsius and 370 degrees Celsius, and they're gonna be carbon chains between 5 carbons and 20 carbons long. Because they're longer chains, they overlap better and have stronger intermolecular forces, and therefore they take more energy to get them to boil or separate from one another and move their way up the tower. Gasoline, kerosene, and diesel fuel would all be classified as medium-sized molecules. This is why, at standard temperature and pressure, they're liquids. The last category is something called the bottoms. The bottoms are very large molecules. They have boiling points over 370, and they're typically chains of carbons over 21 carbons long. Because they're so large, they have very strong intermolecular forces holding them together, and they really don't boil in that fractional distillation tower. They almost feel like grease. This part of the crude oil almost feels greasy and doesn't want to vaporize. You could think of it almost like sludge. Down here would be the larger molecules, lubricants, waxes, bitumen, which is used for asphalt. We just talked about different sized carbon chains within this fractional distillation tower. Now let's take a look at how those carbons are bonded together. We've talked about ionic bonding in this class, but we haven't spent a lot of time talking about covalent bonding, which is what is happening between these carbon atoms. We've already said that a hydrocarbon is a molecule with just carbon and hydrogen. And we can make these hydrocarbons as long as we want based on the number of carbons in the center backbone of that carbon chain. You'll notice down here that it looks like a linear chain. And you can imagine how we could remove this hydrogen on the end and just keep adding carbons until we get chains of well over 20. You'll remember that when we did ionic bonding, that atoms were trying to lose or gain electrons in order to become stable or get a stable octet of electrons around the nucleus. Noble gases are unreactive because they already have that stable octet. But sometimes we want to bond two nonmetals together, and nonmetals typically are both looking to gain. If two nonmetals want to bond, the only way they can stabilize is if they share electrons, therefore filling each other's stable octet. If you remember back from ionic compounds, we talked about the reactivity of an element has to do a lot with the outermost shell of an atom. We call these electrons valence electrons. In the first column, remember, all those atoms have one valence electron. In the second column, all those atoms have two valence electrons, and so until we get the noble gases, which each have eight, except for helium, which has two. You can see here the difference between the different shells, and a valence electron would be here in the outer shell. Okay, you can see that oxygen has six valence electrons in this case because oxygen is in the sixth main group column. So today we're going to be showing you how to make a covalent bond with the valence electrons in the outermost shell of any nonmetal atom. A covalent bond is when we have sharing of valence electrons between two atoms. There are three types. You can have single, double, and triple bonds, but there will not be any quadruple bonds. Just a quick review. Remember, everything in this first row has one valence electron. Everything in the second row has two. We skip the transition metals, and then we go 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Everything in this column has eight, except for helium, you see, has two valence electrons, and that's because there's only two electrons in that first energy level. All right, so a single covalent bond is simply when you're sharing two electrons. So imagine a carbon and a hydrogen are looking to bond together and looking to stabilize their atoms. What would happen is carbon would share one of its electrons with hydrogen, and hydrogen would share one of its electrons with carbon. This creates a single bond. You can see this happening in multiple times in this molecule here of ethane. Right here, right here, right here, right here. Every single bond has two valence electrons present. And now that they're being shared, these valence electrons not only count for the carbon, but they also count for the hydrogen. They count double. Because they're being shared, they count for both. A double covalent bond then would be when they're sharing four. You can see in the middle of this molecule, we have two carbon atoms and we have four electrons being shared in the middle. And you might say, well, there's only two dashes there. Well, when we get to drawing these models, we'll draw a bond using a line. That bond represents two electrons. So this double line here shows us we have a double bond and four electrons present. Where these single lines to the outside show us that we only have one bond and two electrons present. And finally, we have a triple bond, which obviously would have six shared electrons. The molecule C2H2 would be an example of this. You can see this in a couple different ways. You can see here's my carbon, and it's sharing six electrons in the middle. We could also draw this with lines representing bonds, and we draw three lines because each line represents a bond, which is two electrons. All right, now we're gonna practice modeling some of these covalent bonds with different molecules. The first thing we're gonna do is count up all the valence electrons we have available to place. So every atom that's involved in the molecule, we need to count their valence electrons. Then we're gonna start placing those valence electrons in bonds first to join those atoms together. And then finally, we're going to make everyone stable. All atoms need a stable octet except for hydrogen and helium, which each only need two. And eventually, we should get to a molecule that looks something like one of these. You have a central atom in the middle, and there's other atoms around the outside. Let's take a look at some formulas and draw some Lewis structures. This first one here is hydrogen. The first thing we need to do is calculate how many valence electrons this molecule will have. There are two hydrogens, and hydrogen is in the first column. So we take two hydrogens times one valence electron for each hydrogen, and that gives us a total of two valence electrons to place, only two. The next thing we're going to do is draw a skeletal structure of this molecule without any bonds or electrons showing. So since it's just H2, the only way to really draw this is drawing two hydrogens next to each other. Then we're going to draw bonds connecting these together. Well, since there's only two, there's only one bond to draw, and that's in the middle. And we connect the two hydrogens. Remember, this bond represents two electrons. So the questions you should ask when you're done with any drawing is, did I place all my electrons? I was only allowed to place two, and guess what? I have one bond, which means I placed two. So yes, I placed two valence electrons. The next question then would be, is everyone stable? Remember, hydrogens are stable with two electrons. These two electrons in the bond count for this hydrogen, And they also count for this hydrogen. So yes, both of these hydrogens are stable because they both have two electrons associated with it. Let's try another one. This is O2, oxygen. In this case, we have two oxygen, and oxygens each have 6 valence electrons. That's a total of 12 valence electrons we have to place. A little more complicated. The skeletal structure is pretty much the same. We have two oxygens. There's only one way to bond them together. So now, I want to place the 12 valence electrons starting with a bond first. So what I do is I count them as I draw them. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So I placed 12 valence electrons. I cannot place any more. But you'll notice that right here, this oxygen does not have 8 around it. This oxygen has 8 around it right here, right? The right oxygen has 8 valence electrons around it right now, which is perfect. But the left one does not. So what do we do here? If at any point in time you have an electron shortage like we do now, there needs to be more sharing, okay? So what that means is we need to take electrons from the one that has more and share with the one that has less. So we're going to erase these two electrons and put them into a double bond. Now, we've still only placed 12, but this atom here has 8, and this atom here has 8. This is a great example of when you have an electron shortage and more sharing needs to be done, meaning you need a double or maybe even a triple bond. Let's try N2. N is in the 5th main group column and has 5 valence electrons. And since there are 2 of them, that's a total of 10 electrons we can place. So we have 2 nitrogen, and we're going to count to 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All right. Notice the one on the right is stable. The one on the left is short. That means we need to share more. So I'm going to erase these two guys and move them into a double bond. This guy on the right still has 8. The guy on the left, though, only has 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we need to share even more. So we erase these two and make a triple bond. Triple bonds are typically reserved when you have a real shortage in electrons, like in nitrogen. This is the molecule for the nitrogen that's in our atmosphere. Let's do one that has a little more complicated structure. With NH3, we have 1 nitrogen, which is 5 valence electrons, and then we have 3 hydrogens that are each worth 1. This gives me a total of 8 valence electrons that I can place. The skeleton here is a little more complicated, but whenever you see an element first, what that means is more than likely that element's going to be in the middle, and the other elements are going to be surrounding that central element. Now that we have the skeletal structure done, we need to place our 8 electrons. Start with the bonds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and we have 2 more. These hydrogens, remember, they only want one bond. Once they bond once, they're stable because they only need 2. So that means 7 and 8 are going to go on this unbonded side of nitrogen, just like that. So now we've only placed 8, each hydrogen is stable, and this nitrogen is stable because it has 8 valence electrons around it. This is just an introduction on how to draw covalently bonded Lewis structures. There's plenty of practice in the activity. Make sure you practice this and get the hang of this and when to use double and triple bonds. Let me know if you have questions. We'll see you soon.